nice when we do have it. All right, today's scripture reading is from the book of Psalms, chapter 139, verses 23 through 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts, and see if there will be any hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you again, Lord, that even though the enemy may be trying to disrupt our service, Lord, we don't need this technology to worship you. We know that you will hear us. We know, Lord, that you will listen to us in our song and our prayer. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you've given us the freedom and the opportunity to gather together in your name. We know that your word says, where two or more are gathered in your name, you will be there. Lord, we feel your spirit today move among us, touch us, bless us, Lord. And may everything we do be for your glory. These things we pray in Jesus' most blessed and holy name. Amen.
Thank you very much. I sure was glad to see those two guys come over there. My knees are not what they used to be. Well, to be honest, I'm not what I used to be. We all get to a point where we have to depend on people to help us with things that we didn't used to have to depend on them for. And, you know, I've always been kind of a proud guy. But I've learned and been humbled in the last few years that I have to depend on some people for help. And I thank God that he put those people in my life. And so I know all of you were supposed to be on vacation this morning. There wasn't supposed to be anybody sitting here for me to speak this morning. But I hadn't preached in a while. It's been a while since I preached, like Brother Bob. The only thing I'm really worried about is having enough wind to get it out. But there again, I depend on my God. He's the one in charge. If you would, turn in your Bibles to Psalms 51. Going to read the first four verses and then verse 12. It says, be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sins is ever before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Then verse 12 says, restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain me with a willing spirit. Father, I come to you this morning thanking you for the chance to speak for you this morning. I pray now you hide me behind the cross. I pray, Father, you be with everyone here. Father, it's your will to be done, not ours. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I'd like to go ahead and get something clear. I always do every time I preach, especially when I preach somewhere for the first time. This altar is not your preacher's altar. It's not the church's altar. It's God's altar. It makes no never mind. If God tells you to come to this altar to talk to him about something, you come. You're not going to bother me. You're not going to stop me. It's more important that you do what God tells you to do than anything else. And when you learn to do what God tells you to do, then God will begin to bless you. You know, David was probably, undoubtedly, one of the greatest men that ever lived, and definitely the greatest king Israel ever had. He was a man that God said was a man after his own heart, a man that was pleasing to look at, a man that God wanted to be the king of Israel. Now, here's a man that possessed everything that God wanted for his people, yet he became an adulterer and a murderer. A man after God's own heart and a murderer. What a contrast in personalities. What happened to David? What changed him? I want us to look at the life of David this morning and see what happened in his life to create such a change. What broke him enough for him to write Psalms 51? I called my message this morning, The Four S's of David. Now, you can't look at David's life without first looking at his success. David was only a lad when the Israelites were fighting the Philistines. Everyone has heard the story of David, how he took five little stones and went out to face the giant. Saul had tried to give him his armor, but it was too heavy and bulky, and he couldn't move around in it. So he said, I'll just go as I am. And I want you to know that's how God wants us, just as we are. He don't want anything false. He wants you to represent him with honesty and being yourself. False impressions are worthless for God. Now, God had tested David privately with a bear and a lion. And now he was going to test him openly with a giant. You know, that's how God does in our lives sometimes. We fail to realize that sometimes God tests us with small trials in our life to prepare us for the larger battles that we'll have to face in our life. What a great God we have. But when David came up against the giant and the Philistines, they all began to laugh and mock. Look at Israel sending a boy out to fight a man's fight. David, that didn't worry David. First of all, he's too young to worry. But most of all, he knew God was with him. We can face anything when we know God's with us, when God can take care of us. But he went ahead and took a small stone out of his pocket and put it in his sling and declared that he came in the living God of Israel, Jehovah. And he let the stone fly and it struck the giant in the forehead and knocked him to the ground. And David went over and took the giant's sword and cut off his head. Thus began the saying, Saul slew his thousands, David his 10,000. But that wasn't David's first step to greatness. You remember how Samuel was told by God to go down to the house of Jesse and anoint one of his sons to be the next king of Israel. Remember how Samuel went to Jesse's house and he began to talk to all his sons and let them know to determine, but God didn't tell him anything. He had finished talking to what he thought was all the sons, but God hadn't told him anything. And he turned to Jesse and he said, Jesse, you have any more sons? He says, yes, only the lad in the field tending the sheep. He says, go get him. I'll not sit down till he gets here. And when he got there, God told Samuel, this is the one. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, as a boy, he was handpicked by God to be the next king of Israel. Great would David become because of his relationship with God. Saul slew his thousands, but David his 10,000. David's dependency and obedience to God was the key to his success. The key to your success in life is dependent on how close you are to God. That brings us to the next S in David's life. That brings us to his sin. One day, after becoming king, David was walking around the rooftop. He looked down and saw a woman bathing. Now make a note of the word down, for that was David's first mistake. Every step a man takes away from God is a step down. The Bible says that the disciples went down from Jesus, that Samson went down to Timnah, that Jonah went down to take a ship to go to Tarshish. When you look down, you go away from God. And when you go away from God, you always go down. David looked down. It was noon. David should have been praying for his people at noon. It was customary that at noon and in the morning and in the evening, the king would be praying for his people. But this day he forgot, and he got in trouble. He paused. He looked. He lusted. The thought had been planted. Satan had done his job. The thought grew and grew until David would commit the sin of adultery. Listen to me, church. You listen to me, young people. You give the devil an inch, and he'll take a mile. You give him a word, he'll write you a book. You give him a sucking, he'll steal a lifetime. All he needs is for you to look away from God for an instant, and he can take and plant a seed in your heart and mind, and it can grow and ruin your life. If David had just kept on walking when he looked, if he had just said, God, forgive me, take this picture out of my mind, he would have been all right. But he didn't. He hesitated and stopped. And when you do that in your service for God, Satan will win every time. The Bible says that as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Bible said that David sent for her and committed the sin of adultery. It wasn't long before he got the word. She was with child. The man of God's heart had to lie to cover up the sin of adultery. Then he had to commit murder to cover that up. David called for his commander, and he said, the woman's husband, Uriah the Hittite, I want him sent to the hottest part of the battle. And the purpose of that was for he knew he'd probably get killed. And then he could have his wife. David lusted. Then he committed adultery. Then he lied. Then he committed murder. He had to commit one sin to cover up another sin. Then he had to lie further and further and down into sin went David. Now he had killed a man. David, God's man, God's favorite, a man after God's own heart. And with all the looks and the talent, the potential of a brilliant life, forfeited all for one sucking of sinful desire. This brings us to the next S in David's life, his suffering. Excuse me a minute. I knew I needed to bring me a swallow of water. Numbers 32:23 doesn't say, be sure your sins will find you out. I mean, be sure your sins will be found out. It says, be sure your sins will find you out. No one may ever know about the sin in your life, but God knows, and you know. David knew, God knew, and God had let someone else know. There was a faithful prophet in the land that knew what had happened. One day, Nathan, the prophet, came to David and he told him this story and paraphrased it, went something like this. One day, a traveler came through town and this wealthy family wanted to entertain him, but they didn't want to use any of their sheep for the supper. So they went down to this poor man's house and they took the only ewe he had, his only worldly possession. It was all this man had in the world. When David heard the story, he got angry and he cried out, that man must pay fourfold. 2 Samuel 12:7 says that Nathan pointed his little finger at David and said, thou art that man. Lust had caused David to break up a home and steal the wife of a man that loved her with all his heart. He had taken this man's one and only prized possession and then had him killed. When David realized what he'd done, he smote his breast and he said, I have sinned. God, forgive me. Prophet said, David, God's forgiven you of your sin, but the sword shall never depart out of the house of David. And it never did. Remember, David, you've sown your wild oats. Now you will reap the harvest. But also remember, David, you said fourfold. Galatians 6:7 says, whatever a man soweth, that he shall also reap. Anytime you sow, you reap more. And it always comes later. David, you're going to reap more than you've sown. Fourfold. Bathsheba gave birth to a beautiful baby boy. David had his heart set on that young son. Was thrilled about the fact that he was having a new son. But on the eighth day, God called the baby home. The word came, David, the child is dead. Now the first harvest is in the barn. But David, you said fourfold. You can almost hear him as he prays, oh God, would that I had not sinned. Would that I had not looked. Would that I had not hesitated. But he did, and now he would pay. Amnon, David's wicked son, ravished and raped his own sister. David had a daughter named Tamar, and her brother raped her. And now the messenger would come, and David said, David, your daughter has been attacked by your own son. Now the second harvest is in the barn. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. But you, David, you said fourfold. Absalom, David's other son, hearing what had happened to his sister, he tracked his brother down and he killed him to avenge her. Again, the messenger comes through the night. David, King David, I must see the king. The third harvest is in the barn. Amnon, your son, has been killed by his brother Absalom. The sword shall never leave the house of David. You can see David on that same rooftop where it all began, pacing back and forth, knowing that there's one more harvest to come. What will it be? Praying, oh God, I wish I had not hesitated. I wish I had not sinned. But you did, David. And you said fourfold. Absalom led a resistance against his father. One night, as he was riding through the forest, he got his hair caught in the limbs of a large tree. And while he was hanging there, David's men came up on him, and they filled him full of arrows and killed him, not thinking that David wouldn't want him dead. Now the messenger comes again riding through the night and riding through the gate, knocking on his door, crying, "King David! King David!" David cries out, "Oh God, what now? Will the sword never depart from me? What is it? King David, your son Absalom, whom you loved, has been killed by the hand of your own men." David falls to his knees in the same place he first hesitated, looked, and sinned, and cries, "Absalom, Absalom, my son, would that I had died in thy stead." The fourth harvest is in the barn. With all the pain and the agony one can stand, David surrenders. And that brings us to the final S in David's life, his surrender. Time won't allow us to cover David's surrender, Psalms 51, like I would love to. But David wrote the 51st Psalm to detail his surrender to God. One moment of pleasure cost him a lifetime of suffering. It's the gospel of second chance. It's the gospel of restoration. It was for David, and it's also the gospel of restoration and second chances for us. When you get a chance, read it and feel the helplessness that David felt as he wrote, "Have mercy on me, O God." David found out about sin the hard way, the way many of us do. God will forgive us of our sin, but the results of that sin we have to live with the rest of our life. You know, you can take an axe and cut your hand off. God will forgive you, and he'll let that hand heal up, that wound. But you'll live the rest of your life without that hand. Reminds me of a story of this young man. He went to his senior prom. And while he was at the senior prom, he got drunk. And he got in trouble and ended up in jail. To make a long story short, he became the town drunk. His mom went upstairs in the bedroom, and she took a closet door, and she drew a big heart. Painted it red. And every time her son did something against God or that God wouldn't be pleased with, she drove a tack in that door. And it wasn't many years down the road before that heart was filled with tacks. But one day, he got gloriously saved. And he began doing good. And every time he'd do good, that little old mama would go upstairs and she'd take a tack out of that door. Well, the day came. It was time for her to go home to be with the Lord. And he went upstairs to a bedroom with her. And she showed him the door. And the son said, "Can I take that door down, Mom? Can I throw it away?" She said, "Why, son? You've done enough good that all the tacks are gone." But he said, "Mama, the holes are still there." Sin leaves a hole in your life. And there's results to pay for sin. So let me encourage you. If you have anything in your life you need to get rid of, you need to get rid of it this morning. You know, God knows, and you know, if you have something you need to get cleared up with God. You know, I'm 75 years old, not quite as old as some of you, and older than most of you. I've learned one thing. What we do in life, we have to live with. If you're here this morning and you need to get something cleared up with God, don't put it off. Do it today. Do it now. You don't want to meet God ashamed. It says in James, "Oh, that I would not meet Jesus, that I might meet God unashamed." Do what God wants you to do this morning. It's important. You know, Ken read the scripture, "Search me, O God." Well, I was going to talk about that for a moment this morning, but now they didn't come Wednesday night because she's asked me to speak Wednesday night. So I'll just talk about it Wednesday night. Because that was the preparation to David's prayer in Psalms 51. But you need to search yourself this morning. And if there's anything in there that stands between you and God, you need to get rid of it. You know, I don't know a lot of you. Hadn't met you personally yet. But I serve the same God you do. Amen. I can pray for you. I can love you. But if there's something you need to get rid of this morning, you come. And like I said, this is God's altar. It ain't mine. What goes on in that altar is between you and God. It's not between anybody else. So if you need to come this morning, you come. I'm going to come down front and put that in a seat. Thank you. You know, it's like I said, I've had to humble myself. And if you don't want to humble yourself, let your knees get bad. You'll be surprised at how you depend on if you balance when your knees are bad, good. And then when they're not good anymore, you suddenly lose that confidence. But the one thing that I haven't lost confidence in is my Jesus. He takes care of all of it. If you need to come this morning, you come. You want me to pray with you, I'll pray with you. But you know, that's the beauty of knowing Jesus. You ain't got to go through your preacher. You can go straight to the Master. Amen. And take care of it. So, as we sing, if there's something you need to talk to God about, don't put it off. Don't put it off. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. Would you stand as we sing?
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew Spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Pray that all hearts are clear. But like I said, if you know you should have come, know that God knows too. Amen. All of you have a good week. Pray for our pastor. All hearts clear? Anybody want to say anything? Okay. Father, I come to you, Lord. What a great day. Thank you for allowing me to be able to speak for you this morning. Thank you for being my God. Thank you for every individual that's here this morning. God, we can do a lot of things, but one thing that we know above all else is you're in control. Help us to depend on you, to call on you, to love you and praise you according to your loving kindness. Father, be with our pastor today. Watch over him, him and Ellen, and bring them safely home. Be with every individual here today. Go with them to their respective homes. Father, may they glorify you. May they lift you up. May they be strong enough and bold enough to tell someone about Jesus and let Jesus live in their life so that someone else might see. Again, thank you for allowing me to be able to be here this morning. We're going to give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.